Lord, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the things you do. Devil, I've asked you to in the name that's above every name, the name of Joshua Jesus. Because of the word about that, the history of your magnificent word about Salamis, I understand it's a hard teaching, but Devil, this is stuff we need to know essentials as Christians. I pray that you will anoint me and anka that word by anoint disciple tem delenka that word about. Prepare us, Holy Spirit. You be the teacher tonight. They too, brought everyone. In Jesus' name, let your will be done. Amen.
Amen.
When I was getting ready for this study, the Kaaba said, very good, you're going to need study, sir. History, we're going to be getting into a lot of history. What biblical divaya. And I told myself, why would Ron be interested to learn Kakala divaya? Because when I study, I'm not studying to see what I can learn. I want to know what I can bring to the people. Because Uncle George, if I learned a lot and I couldn't give it to you, I failed. See, as a teacher, if I cannot give to you, what by Devleski, and if you leave away without understanding, I failed. And that's not something I want to do. But then it came to my pandemic, born again people need to know what by Devleski. It's easy for me just to tell you that this is the word of God, but I want to prove to you tonight, through history, the traveling that this book took to get to us. Why am I making a lot divaya? Why do we hold these 66 precious books as the word of God? Who are we, Timutas? This is the word of God. What proof do we have? Let me ask you. You're born again, you're baptized, you're a believer. All the information you have, Art, let me ask, who's baptized? Everybody. Who's baptized in the Holy Spirit with the speaking in tongues? Half. Praise God. Who takes communion? Who prays for the sick? We're getting there. Now everybody does something, I'm about to tell you. We all do that because this tells us to. Why do we listen to this book? Just because we say it's the word of God? Or do we actually know because it is the word of God? So that's what I'm going to show you tonight. Why do we obey Kado Divano? Jimmy, let's click it. But let's talk about the Bible. It's an ancient collection of writings. You ready? It's comprised of 66 books, separate books, written over approximately 1,600 years. A Bible wasn't written straight through by one man. It took 1,600 years. The Alaska Kalak Bukfi, written over approximately 1,600 years by at least 45 distinct authors. Now, if we're about 20 guys here, 25 guys, if we was to all leave right now, and give our story of what happened tonight, I'm pretty sure we all have a different take. Why is it that Allah 45 Gajé that never met, that are thousands of years apart, lived from different places, did different things, how are they all in so one accord? Sad, Billy. If me and you together right now, we'll have two different stories, even though we're in the same place. Sad, Sukha Allah Gajé, Stavar Desai Panj Gajé, at least. Amparatsa Sas, Shepherd Sas, Prophet Sas, Regular Gajé Sas. How could they all be on one accord? This has to be a spiritual buchi. Okay. The Old Testament contains 39 books written from approximately 1500 to 400 BC. That's when we get the 39 books of the Old Testament. More about that in a little. And the New Testament contains 27 books written from approximately 40 to 90 AD. So remember that. There's 50 years worth of history in the New Testament. And way more in the Old Testament.
Explain that a little bit,
John. Jimmy, from the Gospels, from the Apostles, until the ending, to the Book of Revelations or 2 Timothy, was a span of 50 years. That's not that far compared to the Old Testament, from the Book of Job, which is the first book written, all the way to the book, the ending book. Some say Malachi, some say Zechariah. But anyway, that's 1,100 years. Big difference.
Big difference.
The original Old Testament was written mainly in Hebrew, with some Aramaic. Daniel has half Aramaic.
But the original Old Testament is Hebrew. Or Zuduo. That's the language they speak today. Very important that we can to know, to study in Hebrew. Now, the New Testament was not written in Hebrew, it was written in Greek. The reason why is because Greek was the language of the time. The main language I just is Spanish. It's a very popular speech. So Greek, over here, since the Romans were in charge, this was a divano. So it was written in Greek and it was a universal language. Okay, so let's continue. Let's give some more facts by Bible. Okay. In between this time, between the Old and New Testament, there was 400 silent years between the Old and New Testament. There was no books written that were inspired by God. There's some historical books. We're going to get to them in a minute. There's 12 of them. There's these are what we call the
Apocrypha.
The Apocrypha, but there's other words I'm trying to get for it. There's 12 books, and these 12 books were not inspired by God. They do not coincide with the Old Testament. We'll get there in a minute. So let's get it. Let's have some more facts about the Bible. Click it again. In the whole Bible, this is just some knowledge. There are 1,189 chapters in the whole Bible. The Old Testament has 929 chapters. The New Testament only has 260 chapters. Big difference. Let's click the verses. There are 31,103 verses in the King James Bible. The Old Testament has over 23,000. The New Testament has 7,958. Why am I giving you this fact? I want to show you why. Click it. Are you ready for this? The Bible, in all these chapters and all these verses, does not try to prove that there is a God. It just tells us that He's there. The Bible doesn't try to prove Kosudil Kutsa. There's nowhere in the Bible where it says, oh, this is why we believe there's a God. Or how is it that God is there? The Bible is not there for you to figure out Kosudil. The Bible is there to figure out Kosantu. God left His word here not to figure Him out, because we can't. We need to know Kosamami. In all these chapters, all these verses, it does not try to prove that God exists. It simply says, in the beginning, God created. You see, a lot of people, guys, some non-believers, say, you need any Bible. But if you don't believe in God, you ain't going to find a scripture that's going to, oh, now I believe in God. The scripture said it. They're not going to believe it anyway. So God is talking to you, to the believer. These 66 books are 66 love letters to you, to the church.
Amen.
Have you ever read somebody else's mail? Doesn't make no sense, but your mail makes sense. You see, because the word of God is for you, it's delivered to you. The unbeliever, it's not his mail. It's not going to make any sense to him, but your mail is going to make sense to you. That's the Bible. It doesn't mean anything to them. It's not delivered to them. But when a son born again, a son of the Vesco, it's mail delivered straight to you. Amen.
Amen?
Amen? Let's talk about the Old Testament again. 443 BC, this is a long time ago, the completion of all the books of the original Hebrew manuscripts were made up, the Old Testament, they were complete. These 39 books in the Old Testament, they were all written by 443. You ready? 200 BC, that's over 200 years later, the completion of the Septuagint. Now let me tell you what that means. I know very hard to fire, but I'm going to get there. Remember I told you the Greek language was very important. So they took the Old Testament, 70 rabbis did it in 70 days. They translated the Hebrew into the Greek. That's what Septuagint means, 70. They took these Old Testament books and made them universal for everybody to read.
But what is the word?
Septuagint means 70. Well, 70 prophets did in 70 days, so they used it.
In Greek.
Yeah, translated from Hebrew to Greek. Now, look at this. The completion of the Septuagint of Greek manuscripts, which contained the translation of the 39 books of the Old Testament and the 14 books of the Apocrypha. So here we go. Now we're getting to these books that are kind of taboo.
We're getting to these 14 books that really don't go with the Bible.
The Maccabees
and the book of the
Catholic.
Many other books. It doesn't really originate from the Catholic Church. It originates in a silent period of time when God wasn't talking to his people.
Wow.
So something happened here that these people who translated it in the Greek, to they vi kakala book fi on the Bible. So now there's 80 books. Something's fishy here. Now, this is a major council. In 90 or 95 AD, somewhere in that time, the council of Jamnia, a Jewish council, met to revise the books of the canon, or the Old Testament, as it's known to the Christians. Here's the criteria. Here's how the Old Testament made it.
This is how the books make it into the Old Testament. They have to fit these four buchai. You ready?
The books had to confirm what was written in the law, in the Torah, in the Pentateuch. It couldn't be anything oprach hakaladivaya because they knew the Torah was from God. For instance, Torah penat and adazuma manutzosak asumulo because it's against the Bible.
Other books were telling you you could. So automatically you know those books ain't good.
It goes against the word of God.
So it had to be written in the Hebrew language. It had to be written in Palestine, that's Israel. And the books had to be written before 400 BC. One result of this was the removal of the 14 books known as the Apocrypha.
Zumadao duzmano to bring kado false doctrine andra.
These extra 14 books. Kainela mega purgatory. Kainela mega bud bucha kanagorta on the Bible. He creeped in with the Apocrypha to the Jews, but the Jews were so blessed of God at the time, they realized their error, and they got rid of it 100 years later. They removed these extra 14 books, and they're down to the 39 books that we still have till today. So we understand, Brother Yamama?
I know hard teaching, sir, but bear with me, and we'll get there.
No, John, you're doing good.
Now here goes the New Testament. Remember, it got finished in somewhere between 50 and 90 AD when it was penned down. But there were many, many books by other writers, other church fathers. And a lot of people considered that they should be in the New Testament too.
So, the Laodicean Council, remember the church, Laodicea, the book of Revelations?
Langul Council, this is that same area. The Laodicean Council meets in 360 AD to decide which books and writings will be accepted as Holy Scripture. The Greek Septuagint, the Old Testament, is accepted. They already have the 39 books. They don't have to decipher. They took the 39 books in. So now the New Testament comes in. The criteria for the New Testament writings include, you ready? That they must be written by an apostle, Jesus' original followers, or during the time that the apostles lived. And they must support the true doctrine and must have widespread usage. They couldn't be in a small area. They had to be world known, Kakala Divaya. They had to be written by an apostle, original follower of Jesus, or at the same times that those disciples and apostles had a chance to look over at what's one. This is good, this is from the Lord. Anything after the death of the apostles is not considered New Testament.
Now, you ever see the Gnostic Gospels on the History Channel? Yeah. Talks about the Gospel of Judas, the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Nicodemus. They were not written by those people. It just carries their names.
These books do not go with the New Testament. They were not written in the times of the apostle, and they do not support the doctrine of the Bible. They were never accepted into the canon of the Bible. These 27 books were written by or during the time of the apostles.
Great. Let's continue.
So this goes on, and 30 years later, in that 100 years, our Lord bottled false religion, the Roman Catholic Church, and they took over. That's the leadership of Christianity. Now remember something. The only thing that can save a person is the Word of God.
That's right.
Al Duzmano's biggest weapon he has is to hide the Word of God from you and from me. Because if you don't know the Bible, and if you don't hear the words of God, you can never truly be born again. So now,
Here it goes.
The Roman Catholic Church is going. 390 AD. This is 300 years after Molay apostles. The originals are dead and now it's widespread. Jerome's Latin Vulgate translation of the Bible is produced and in wide circulation. It includes all 80 books, including the Apocrypha. They put them back in.
The 14 books that they took out, because Odusmano was trying to blind the eyes of the Jew, it didn't work.
So now he's trying to put him in the New Testament, and he's trying to blind the eyes of the church.
Amazing. Amazing.
These 14 books are what God played towards the Bible.
Wow.
And they're trying to get back in. Now let's get some more history. The Vulgate is a late 4th century Latin version of the Bible, and largely the result of the labors of St. Jerome, who was commissioned by Pope Demasus I in 382 to make a revision of the old Latin translation. You ready? And ultimately it became the definitive Latin version of the Bible in the Roman Catholic Church.
Ever get out in the Catholic congregation, me personally, as a kid, I went maybe kind of molomogo papo before in Murmutsa, but I never attended Catholic Church. But as una viajes, they read in Latin.
Now, for those who went to the Catholic congregation,
did you ever understand anything they said?
Never.
Never. All right, so you went up on the case as an adult, so you know what it is. Did you ever understand anything?
I made them understand what this person said, Santana.
Should've.
We never understood.
You never understood. Because look what happens. Now we have the Bible in Latin, and the Pope makes the law that there should be no other Bible translation but Latin.
But Latin is not the main language. Greek is. It's not a popular language, but they said
this is a holy language.
These 80 books can only be written in Latin. And here's the problem. It stays like that for 1,000 years. Almost, it's a little shy of 1,000 years. But if me abors, no translation of the Bible.
Nobody knew the Bible. If you look at church history, nothing happened in those 1,000 years, Kakangari. You never heard no big event, no reformation, no Baroa born again, no big revivals. Nothing went on because no one knew the Bible.
If I'm not mistaken, John, in those days no one owned the Bible. Just the church.
Just the Catholic Church. They would have the Bible chained down
to the
pulpit.
Yeah.
And you weren't allowed to read it. The only person who could read it was the church fathers. I picked on the Latin. And you was not allowed to ask what it meant. So here's what happens. I know it sounds crazy what I'm telling you. But this is why there was nobody born again. Because they were not hearing the true word of God. Avilo Duzmano, I'm the Catholic community. And he blinded the eyes of the people for 1,000 years. Could you imagine to now Sunil
Kornik and what by Devleski for 1,000 years? Not to hear about Jesus for 1,000 years.
Now, the Old Testament, you could still have in Hebrew, because obviously it's Zudawongasa. But the Old Testament ain't going to save us. The New Testament is. So, Duzmano is not working on the Old Testament anymore. He's working on the New Testament. So, here comes Yek Gajo, 1,000 years later. John Wyclef. He finishes the first translation of the entire Bible in English. 1,000 years later. His version, he finishes his version and copies of it are handwritten.
Wow.
No printing press. No nothing. So God, you sir, imagine the Bible to write it down.
Wow. You can't make a mistake.
Translate.
So he did this for about 40 years. He didn't really get anywhere. Jamie, he couldn't really produce as many as he could have. He had to translate it from the Hebrew and Greek to English and then copy that.
And that was done in secrecy, John.
And that was, that in those days, he wasn't allowed to translate it.
It was against the law.
You would be killed if you translated it from the Latin. John Wyclef, a man of God, decided that people should know the word of God. Okay, he dies, and nothing don't go on for another 20, 30 years. A few other translations here and there. But here comes the main guy. This guy I'm going to tell you about, his nickname is the Prince of the Bible. the prince of the English Bible, because he's one of the main translators. Wobbuchilas William Tyndale. If you look at a lot of Bibles in the back, it has Tyndale. That's the name of a company now. Yeah, Tyndale. I have some books by that.
Yes.
It's a very, very important person to the original fathers of the church. William Tyndale's New Testament is completed in 1525. Tyndale was committed to taking the Bible directly to the people. See, that's our goal as Christians. Taking the Bible to the people. Getting it out of the church. You see, if we only got the Word of God, and this goes for Simeka and Aze Bible, the teachers. If we only have the Word of God in the church and we don't take it to the people, we're just as good as the Catholic Church who had it chained down and was speaking in Latin. You see, you have to want to bring the Word to the people. And that's when people change. But if we're only sharing and teaching with each other, it's like chaining down the Bible and speaking in Latin. Expressing open defiance of the Pope, Nazis Kadad, Nazis Kalajav. By August of 1525, oh here, let me tell you something. In the middle of that 100 years between John Wycliffe and William Tyndale, of Gajobisholas Gutenberg's, and he made a printing press. The first book ever written on the printing press was the Bible. The first book that was ever printed by a Masunka, Sazi Wadbai Divis. So, here goes William Tyndale. He does this, the New Testament is complete. He's on call. Printing at Cologne, they're printing. He's already printing the Bibles. Not my handwritten. But when the authorities forbid the project, Tyndale escaped to Worms. That was another town. Where 6,000 copies were printed. Dice easy. He printed 6,000 copies and sold in England by April of, by 1526. Now did. Official opposition in England led to the destruction of most of these early manuscripts and copies. Now, doesn't that sound good? 6,000 copies could have. But here's Sokaran Zegaje. They were buying them and burning them. They were taking the Bible when he was complete with it, but they didn't want it to go on in any other language, and they would burn it. But they thought they were doing bad to him, Uncle George. But he only finished the New Testament, and he needed the money to make the Old Testament. So the money they were buying the New Testament with, he could go and make the Old Testament.
Wow. Oh, very good.
Wow. So this is what he's doing. Yeah, so he's working on it. 1536, he's already doing this since 10 years. William Tyndale was executed. Tyndale did not live to complete his Old Testament translation. On May 21st, 1535, he was arrested and later executed for heresy. Gudominupi, a very big disagreement with the Word of God. They locked him up, Baji, because he's doing something wrong against the Word of God. I'm always trying to preach the Word of God.
John, one question.
Yes.
You were saying the defiance of the Pope.
Yes.
He was talking against the Pope.
The Pope only wanted the Bible in Latin.
Right.
And not for the common man to know it.
Right.
Lest with defiance, us, he wanted everybody to know it.
So he against them.
Yeah? He told them, a matter of fact, there was a saying in that they whooped that, I want for the choir boys to know more than the Pope out of the Bible.
Okay.
That was his saying in those days. So, look what happens. He dies. He's arrested and later executed for heresy in Belgium. On October 6, 1536, while they're burning him, he's locked up and they're burning him, he's dying. Dixosas, his dying prayer was that the Lord would open the eyes of the king. Open the eyes, keep it now, Lord, forgive me, Lord, watch over me, Lord, no, open the eyes of the king, and then let the Bible go on. His prayer was answered a few years later. 2 years later, a congregation of England accepted the New Testament, accepted the Old Testament. Somewhere in that time, in the 1500s, there was a Bible called the Geneva study, the Geneva Bible. And that's where we first see chapters and verses. There were no chapters and verses in the Bible until the Geneva Bible. Now here comes the main New Testament translation, the King James Version of the Bible. This is called also the Authorized Version. Or my important translation to some of the Bible, most respected worldwide, is the King James. And look what it says, the King James Version Bible, commissioned by King James I of England, the King James Bible was made to create, this is why it was made, a translation that was accurate, acceptable and beautiful enough for a king. The work begun in 1604 and completed in 1611. 7 years. The translation is the work of a committee of 47 scholars.
Now, Walter Gage from all over the world and Michael Javid Gage in this area were brought in and they translated this book for 7 years.
These 47 scholars that made up the Hampton Court Conference, that was their nickname after. Stay there.
I know I gave you everything about the Word of God, how it traveled and it got to us. From then on, we have it. Praise God. But does that prove to us that this is the Word of God? I'm just giving you the history, how we got it. I borrow history, Demetri. This, and honestly, took hours of study. And when you read out this Gage, so de Chino Kale, so de Mudaranas de Gage, so de Panavenas de Gage, so much suffering. Abjan, that was those days. It still goes on. Right now in the China, there's Christians that have church on the ground. They're not allowed to tell anybody they're Christians. Let me tell you a fast story before we continue.
They're having an underground church service, and this is a true story. I'm not saying it to sound good. It's true.
Gage Prichona de Kangarin, it's in the basement on Kondiki. Avene Labaran, they're locking up the church. They grab the Bible, and they place it at the corner. You know the story, Uncle George? And they place the Bible in the corner. And they said, we're going to lock up everybody in here, and we're going to execute you. Unless you walk out, I tell you, it's a deal. It's a true story. If you spin on the Bible, you're free to walk out. The whole church, including the pastor, spit on the Bible and walked out. Yekterni Laklaga, about 16 years old, got down on the knees and they're expecting me wait to chumel. Slapiskobal, I koslav, or chungar kaisas. And they killed her on the spot. For the Word of God. We have bookstores and Bible stores and internets and computers and pastors and churches and we don't care about the Bible. All this Chino Kachale Gage, all Kadabu Chino Kachale Gage. And you know what we do with the Bible? Whoever's preaching, if it's a good preacher, will be there.
What about the Word of God? What about the people who suffered then in Kadab Divano? And what about the Blessed? But let's get back to the teaching. The Quran. It's a holy book of a religion. Let's click it, Jimmy. There's a few other ones. The Book of Mormon. We want their religion. It's a book. Let's click it again. This is Hinduism. The Vedas. Stay there. All right, leave it right there. Out of all these books and all these religions, how do we know that this is the Word of God? Sarchi Janazame, the Quran is right. Sarchi Janazame, the Book of Mormon, Joseph Smith is right. Why is it that we have to take Kakala Divaya?
Now, it's easy for me to say this in church, but when you go outside and you talk to a Muslim, Gajo, are you going to be able enough to tell him your proof why you think the Bible is the Word of God at this night?
Wow.
Yeah.
And you tell him about the Bible. No, that's the only Word of God. Are you prepared to just answer why you believe in Christianity? This is Christianity. This is why we need to know these things. Now, there's many reasons. There's archaeological. There's a historical value on the Bible that we can see. But I want to show you what I think is the main reason why we could take the Bible for what it's worth. Let's click it, Jimmy. One major way to know the Bible is the Word of God is prophecy. No one knows the future except Odile. I want to tell you, all these books that I mentioned, these other religious books, have wise sayings. But Michael, they're all lacking one thing, prophecy. Because none of them knew the outcome. As a matter of fact, they have historical mistakes. They have things in their books that, for instance, say the world ain't round and you can't land on the moon. And that's against history. The Bible taught us that the world was round when everybody thought it was flat. Christopher Columbus was a Christian. And he knew the world was round because the Bible said it. The Bible says there's millions of countless stars. Because he thought there was only Sodikas. After the invention of telescopes, they realized so. And the Bible says God named them all. The history of the Bible is unbelievable. But the prophecies of the Bible are even more. I want to show you something about Jesus.
In the Old Testament, there are at least 332 prophecies and predictions of the Messiah, or Jesus. But this is in the Old Testament. And they were all literally fulfilled by our Lord Jesus. 332 prophecies at least were fulfilled by Jesus in those years that he was bepoof. Now there's some prophecies that are easy to fulfill. Like, I can fulfill them too. He'll come to Jerusalem on a donkey. I can do that. My heart, mother. I'll get a donkey, travel to Jerusalem. There's many things that Jesus did to fulfill prophecy that any of us here can do. But there's many he couldn't. Let's click and I'll show you. Agassiz did a study conducted at MIT. This is a major Castellan professors and they study mathematics. It's a very important thing. And they studied this. Many of the prophecies concerning the Messiah were totally beyond human control. His birthplace, time, manner of death, people's reactions, piercing of his side, burial, resurrection, where did his body go? By using the modern science of probability in reference to just 8 of these prophecies. Now remember, he fulfilled 300 and how many, Michael? 332? We're only going to talk about 8. Okay? 8. There's a big difference. Out of 332, I'm going to tell you the odds that MIT did about 8. Are you ready? The chance that any man might have lived to fulfill all 8 prophecies is 1 in 1 trillion.
100 trillion.
In 100 trillion. Dig. To illustrate this point, if we take 100 trillion silver dollars and lay them on the face of Texas, they would be 2 feet deep. Now we mark one of these silver dollars and thoroughly stir the whole mess all over the state. Now blindfold the man and let him travel as far as he wishes, but he must pick only 1 silver dollar with a mark on it.
What's the odds?
Impossible.
It's the same odds with 8 prophecies that Jesus fulfilled.
Wow. Amazing.
So is the Bible true? We have fact after fact after fact that it's true.
These guys were fighting for a reason, because they knew the word of God was true. And disciples, they were hiding.
Would they go, so I can call the pastor, and go to the death for a lie?
They knew Jesus resurrected. They knew the New Testament. They knew the Bible was true. This is why they stuck to it.
What does the Bible say about itself? 2 Timothy 3:16 in the King James Version. All Scripture, that's all the New Testament, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Amen. This is why we have a Bible.
Amen.
Let's show you another translation, NIV. So, NIV, 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching and goes on. Can I ask you guys a question? When was the other time we saw God's breath?
Sodom?
Adam.
When he created Adam. What did he breathe? The breath of life. God's breath equals life.
Very good.
And the word of God is God's breath. When you're in the word of God, that's where you find life.
Amen.
He breathed into Adam and he became alive. The word of God is what his breath is. And if you're going, if you need to be alive and if you think you're dead on the inside, this is God's breath.
Amen.
This is what makes you alive. But John, boring Mongol Christianity, dead Mongol water. So you're right. It is dead, but you need the word of God to be alive. Christianity without the word of God is as good as a manuska sumolo. Bottom line, when you read the word of God, that's kind of kajo juvino on the deal. I think we have something else to check. And we got a test at the end. Oh, this is good. You ready? The Bible calls itself a sword. We got 2 verses. Ephesians 6:17. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Let's click it. Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is living and active. Hallelujah. Sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. The word of God knows not only Chugundira, it knows what's in your heart. It knows your secret things, things that you don't know. Osama Spindah, Devla, cleanse me from my hidden thoughts, my secret sins, even the ones I don't know about. There's things on the tree, Loka, Chijanastut.
Borodil Janel Trupiski Warba.
Cleanse down my hidden faults, Psalms 19. I want to continue. I got a question.
So after we learned all this about the Word of God,
why do some people read the Bible and nothing happens?
That's what gets me.
They don't believe.
That's true. Why is it that one person hears the Word of God and his life is born again, his life has changed, but the guy next to him heard the Word of God and it was the same thing if I was reading a Time magazine?
Nothing. Why? Okay, let's look at the Word of God. The Word of God... No, Jimmy, go back. The Word of God is powerful. Changes lives. But you need something to go with the Word of God.
Or someone.
Who do you need to help you when you're in the Bible? Let's click the Jimmy. The Spirit. If you don't pray and ask the Holy Spirit to give you guidance before you read your Bible every time, you ain't got nothing. It's like reading a newspaper or a magazine. But I want to show you something if you didn't catch it yet. You see the Word of God and you see Spirit. Let's click it, Jimmy. Put the S in front of Word and you've got a sword. Let's click it. I got a picture there. You see, you can only have the Word, but if you don't have the Spirit, you'll never have a sword.
Wow.
Very good.
Let that one sink in.
Very good.
Very good.
You'll only have the Bible, but once you have the Holy Spirit that guides you in the Bible, it becomes a sword.
Amen.
And that's when you have victory. That's when lives change. That's when things happen.
How do you get the Spirit? You pray before you read the Bible?
You always pray before you read the Bible. There was a prayer in the Bible. There's a prayer in the Bible that was called, open my eyes, that I may behold your words. Psalms 119, verse 18. Okay, guys, that was your teaching. Let's thank God. Praise the Lord.